Hey, what's up everyone? This week, I want to show you a pretty cool trick that you can use whenever you want to test some business logic that is embedded inside a complex object, like a view for instance, and that you don't want to spend too much time to refactor your code. So let's get started and actually have a look at such a situation. As you can see in the code behind me, I've implemented a simple SwiftUI view called star rating. The purpose of this view is to let the user give a rating on a scale from 1 to 5, so something that we are all very familiar with in iOS apps. And I want to direct your attention to this code right here, so the code inside the modifier on tap gesture, because that code implements the business logic of my view. As you can see, I say that if the new rating is different than the current one, then I update the rating with the new value. But on the other hand, if the rating is the same than the current one, then I reset the rating to 0. So let me run the app just to show you what's the result of this code. As you can see, here is my custom SwiftUI view. And so if I set a different rating than the current one, the rating is updated with the new value. But on the other hand, if I try to set the same rating than the current one, then it is reset to 0. And so now let's say that I want to write a unit test that will make sure that this code does work as expected. Right now, it's actually impossible for me to write that unit test because the only way this code can get executed is if it is triggered by a UI interaction. Of course, I could still write a UI test that would interact with the UI of my app, but I don't think that's such a great solution because UI tests are costly, and also because I want to be able to test my business logic in isolation with the actual UI of my app. So if I want to write that unit test, I will need to refactor my code in order to make it possible for this business logic to be called outside of a UI interaction. So I'm going to begin by doing what might be the obvious first solution, which is to extract this business logic inside a dedicated method. So it would look something like this. I've created a new method updateRating that encapsulates my business logic. And then inside the modifier onTapGesture, I simply call that new method. So now that we have this method updateRating, it feels like it should be quite easy to write a unit test because we just need to create a value of type starRating, call the method updateRating on it, and check that the property rating has indeed the value that we expect. So let me actually start writing this test. So for this, I'm going to move to my testing target and I'm going to implement a first test for the case where the new rating is different than the current one. I need to create a value of type star rating. So let's go ahead. And as you can see, when I try to create that value, we face an unexpected difficulty, which is that the initializer of star rating expects a binding to an integer to read and write the current rating. That's not an issue in itself because I could create a custom binding inside my test, but still, this would require some extra code. And also, it would kind of couple my unit test with the inner workings of SwiftUI. And as I've said, that's not a good practice. I want my unit test to be as independent from the UI framework as possible. So let me go back to the code of my view and let's ask ourselves, is there another way that we could refactor this code in order to make this method updateRating completely independent from SwiftUI? And I'm going to add a second constraint, which is that I want to keep the refactor as simple and short as possible. For instance, I could, of course, create a view model that would be responsible of handling the business logic of the view, but I don't want to do this. I think it's too complex for that simple situation. I want a more simple solution. And as it turns out, there is such a simpler solution, which is to take my method updateRating and update its signature to turn it into a static method. So what's the difference between a regular method and a static method? It's actually quite simple. A regular method, you call it on a value of the type where it is defined. So here, my method updateRating, when it was a regular method, I would call it an instance of type star rating, and the static method instead, you call it on the type itself. So you can really see a static method as a global function, except that it is still part of a type. And the big advantage with this static method is that in my test, I will be able to call the method directly on the type star rating, and so I won't need to create a value of type star rating beforehand. Of course, this advantage comes with a drawback, and that drawback is that since the method update rating is now static, it is of course no longer able to read and write two properties of values of type star rating. So I will have to update the signature of the method. First, I'm going to add a new argument that will be the current rating. And wherever inside my method I was reading the value of the property rating, I will instead be using this new argument. And also, since I can no longer assign to the property rating, I will have to introduce a return value to my method. And so wherever I was assigning to writing, I will now instead be returning a value. And before I move on to updating the call site right here, there is one last change I must make to the signature of the method update writing, and it's to update its name actually, because the name update writing kind of implies a side effect, and that's no longer the case since the method has become static. And so I need to change the name, and instead of update writing, it will now be called updated writing. And now I can finally update my call site right here. So first I use the new name of the method. Then I also pass the second argument, which is the current writing. Then I also use the return value of the method. And finally, since the method is static, I need to make it explicit. I'm calling it on the type and not the value itself. And I do it by using self with a capital S. So before I move back to my test, let me just run the app in the simulator once more, just to make sure that I haven't broken anything. And it seems I haven't broken anything. The view is still working as it was before. So now let me get back to my testing code. And this time, thanks to the static method I've just introduced, I will finally be able to write a test for my business logic, and that test will be completely independent from SwiftUI. So I'm going to get rid of this old code. Instead, I'm going to set the parameters of my test. Then I'm going to store the result of calling my static method. So to call it, I use the type star writing, and on that type, I call the method updated writing. I pass the arguments for the new writing and the current writing. And finally, I just need to assert that the result is indeed the one I expect. And of course, I'm going to do the same thing for the case where the new writing is the same than the current writing. To gain some time, I'm just going to paste the code because the logic is exactly the same than with the previous test. I have my parameters for my test right here. Then I call my static method. And finally, I assert that in that instance, the result is equal to zero. And all that's left to do is to actually execute the test to make sure that they are indeed passing. And as you can see, everything is green. So we have successfully implemented some tests for the business logic that is used inside the view star rating. And of course, the very nice thing here is that in order to make this business logic testable, I didn't need to carry out a big refactor of my app, like for instance, by introducing a view model. I just had to extract the business logic inside a static method. That static method is still a part of my view, but since it is a static method, I am also able to call it outside of SwiftUI. And so, for instance, in my unit test code, I am able to very easily call the static method, give it some arguments, and check that the return value is indeed the one that I expect. And that's all I wanted to show you for this week. As always, if you have any questions or feedback, please let me know in the comments. Thank you for watching, and see you next time.